Good afternoon. My name is Sendurai Mani. I'm a professor of pathology and lab medicine and also an associate director for translational oncology at Brown University, Legorreta Cancer Center, Brown University. So today, I'm going to walk you through how the cancer originates and then, you know, what can we do to prevent or get ourselves checked properly. So before that, I just want to let you know that our body is like a community where we have more than 30 to 40 trillion cells. They work together symbiotically. We have a digestive system which kind of digests the food. It's like a food processing machinery, cleaning machinery, and we have all kinds of system, including an army to destroy any foreign invaders. So this slide shows that how in animal kingdom, the symbiosis play a vital role in keeping everyone healthy and happy. Same thing happens in our human body. So again, we have nearly 30 trillion cells. And we also have a bacteria in our body, which is almost 38 trillion in our human body. And they all work together. Unfortunately, cancer is still a major problem. Cancer, it doesn't discriminate anyone. It's like a thief. It penetrates or invades our life and steals our health, happiness, and our wealth, everything from us. It doesn't discriminate whether it's young or old. It doesn't discriminate whether you are a male or a female, or your ethnicity, or you are rich or poor. It doesn't matter. It affects everyone. So it's extremely vital for us to understand what it is, why people do get cancer. If you understand that better, it's easier for us to prevent it and diagnose at the right time. So that slide shows in the world, we have nearly 20 million people diagnosed with cancer in 2020. And among that, 10 million of them died because of cancer. In the US, it's the good news, the cancer incidence is dropping down every year. This slide shows that you can see that from the top curve, which shows cancer incidence in male and female, and in the bottom you see the cancer-related mortality, it's dropping down. It's really dropping down. But we still have quite a lot of cancer-related death in this country. We saved nearly 2.5 million men and 1.5 million women's life in the last 10 years due to advanced diagnosis as well as treatment options. We will walk you through. I'll walk you through most of that in the next few slides. However, there's one cancer we still don't have a good solution is pancreatic cancer. Here you can see the cancer incidence is going up and cancer-related mortality is also going up both in male and female. So we need to understand that better. Moreover, you know, if somebody has a localized disease, let's say breast cancer, the survival rate is extremely high, 99%. But on the other hand, somebody has a metastasis. So this is a localized disease. If somebody has a metastasis or somebody has liver or pancreatic cancer, again, the survival rate is extremely low. So I'm going to walk you through about three different type of cancer. The reason is, you know, many times people come and ask me, my uncle has a cancer, my aunt has a cancer, will I get a cancer? So we need to understand these different type of cancers which exist so that you understand whether if somebody has a cancer, will I get a cancer? For example, there are three major types we call. One is called a sporadic, which happens due to our lifestyle. That is called hereditary. It's due to a mutation in parents, or could get transmitted to the progeny. That's a hereditary. That's a familial, where it's a combination of both hereditary and the environment where they live in. The combination together causes the familial cancer. So before that, we need to understand what is DNA, what is gene, and how people get cancer if somebody has a mutation or inherited some genetic defect. So here you see on the left, you have a cell, and cell has chromosomes, you could see, and inside the nucleus. And those chromosomes is made up DNA. And the DNA makes genes. My daughter asked me, what is the difference between DNA and genes? She's 11 years old. And so I thought of this example where you think about road in Providence. All the roads, you could call it as a DNA. But within that, there's a Smith Street, which you can see a small stretch of road is called a Smith Street. Same thing. You have a meter-long DNA in each cell, and a small portion of that DNA is called a gene. And so now comes how cancer happens in human being. Just think about a car, okay? I said we have 30 to 40 trillion cells in human body. Now, each cell is like a car, just imagine. Now, a car has a brake, an accelerator, a gas. So brake, when you are going fast, you can apply a brake. When you are not going faster, you can apply an accelerator. You go fast. When the gas tank gets empty, the car cannot go anywhere. Same way, we have a brake system. It's called a tumor suppressor. If among this 30 to 40 trillion cells, one cell decide to go rogue, the brake system works and stops the cell from going rogue. But imagine somebody has a mutation in another set of gene called oncogene, then you are constantly pressing the gas, the car will continuously go. Still, there is one more brake, one more kind of control system, which is a gas. Once the gas tank is empty, the car cannot go anywhere. So you have a third set of control. So in body, we have a clock system which senses how many times a cell can divide. Same way, how many years a human can live, each cell among this 30 to 40 trillion cells has a clock. It will sense this many times you can divide, then you need to stop and die. That's a programmed cell death. So that is determined by something called a telomerase. They have a limited cycle. What happens in cancer, they turn on an enzyme called a telomerase. They keep adding telomeres to the end so they don't stop. So these are the three major hurdles a normal cell has to gain to become a cancer cell. So, which is summarized here. So you need to mutate the tumor suppressor gene, mutate the oncogene, become active, then have a continuous activation of telomerase to have like almost like a solar-powered gas tank, solar-powered car, so you can run on a sunlight as long as you have a sunlight. So this is kind of puts the cell into a crazy signaling system, which the cell responds by dividing and creating more cells of themselves, and that end up in a tumor. But you also want to understand this cancer is mostly age-related disease. So in other words, most of the time, because we live longer, we tend to accumulate more mutation over a period of time due to our lifestyle. And that's what is shown in this slide, where you see people getting cancer only late in life. So this slide shows that if somebody has a mutation in this tumor suppressor gene, the genes also called brake genes, which I was mentioning earlier, that so those can be inherited from parents to the progeny, to the children. But just because somebody inherits a mutation doesn't mean that they will get a cancer. Remember, there are three steps a normal cell has to pass in order to become a cancer cell. What it means is that if they get a mutation from their parents, inherited a mutation from the parents, which means they are prone to get a cancer, but they are not going to get a cancer. So here, a kid having a retinoblastoma mutation in a retinoblastoma gene, RB gene, is developing a tumor in the eye, something APC, which is creates a colon tumor. And then you see on the right, Angelina Jolie, she had a mutation in a gene called a BRCA1, which is a tumor suppressor gene or the brake gene. And she decided to go and do a mastectomy of both her breasts just to prevent cancer from occurring, not because she had a cancer. So again, the environmental effect play a vital role. So pollution, drinking, over-drinking alcohol, stress. Stress is a major player. So take time off, enjoy your life. Microbiome, you know, we all take microbiome for granted. I said there are 38 trillion bacteria in our body. So if you kill them, they are going to create its own consequences. So be respectful of your microbiome. And, you know, smoking, eating junk food. So it also adds to cancer. So what I have done. So when I was at MIT many years ago, people in the Weinberg lab where I did my research, here is a gentleman in his lab, they found that you can transform a normal cell into a cancer cell in a laboratory by inactivating the tumor suppressor, getting rid of the break, having a tumor oncogene, and having a telomerase, they were able to make cancer cells. So what I found, those cancer cells don't go anywhere because they are epithelial cells attached with one another. That's what happens, and that's why all the cells in our body, they are attached with one another. In order for them to go from one place to another, they need to break this cell-cell adhesion, cell matrix interaction. Now they can go anywhere in the body. It's called epithelial to mesenchymal transition. So in addition, when a pathologist look at a tumor in a lung, a pathologist could predict that tumor in the lung is coming from breast or prostate or lung or liver just because they create a structure very similar to where they come from. So I hypothesized that tumor cells not only become migratory but also become stem cells. That turned out to be true. Now, targeting cancer stem cells become a major issue because they are responsible for metastasis, tumor relapse, and treatment resistance. We are in the process of developing treatment for metastasis. So, until now, you know, the treatment has been more just one kind of treatment. If somebody has a cancer, they used to get one type of treatment, chemotherapy or some treatment. Recently, we have invented this precision oncology where you have a patient, you classify them by sequencing their tumor, you classify them into group who has a different mutation in their tumor oncogene, the accelerator genes. Now, based on that, we have drugs for each mutation, so you can give medicine to the patient into different groups, and you get a benefit in among all the three groups. So this is, for example, an example where a patient had a mutation in a BRAF gene, which is one of the oncogene. Now, you give a drug which targets that mutation, the tumor is completely gone. And there's a problem which the tumor can relapse, but that's another problem which we are in the process of addressing. Here is Jim Allison, who really revolutionized cancer treatment recently. He found that the tumor cells somehow convinces immune cells not to kill them. So he found that secret code, which tumor cells tell the immune cells that I'm your friend. He went ahead and blocked that signal. By doing that, he's able to make the immune cells kill the tumor cells. That is really making a huge impact. If somebody has a melanoma, some time ago we say it's a death sentence. No longer the case. You can really treat them with immunotherapy. So the future is really bright. For example, olden days when somebody wants to get a colonoscopy for a colon cancer screening, it's very hard. Now there's a company here, they have developed a small camera, which is like a pill you ingest. It just goes through your stomach, it pictures the whole gut, and you get a picture of what happens inside. There's another company on the right, Olive Diagnostics, developed a toilet seat where you sit when you are doing what you are doing. It can kind of capture what is anything wrong in the urine and give you an information. And you know, there's another thing called digital twins, which is quite an interesting idea. So you guys are all constantly feeding data into various companies using wearables, as well as your genomic sequencing and all that. With that, people are able to create a digital twins of you. And with that, one could predict what kind of medicine you may need. So here is a company, they have announced launch of Gemini, the in silico patient for multiple myeloma. So it's basically digital twins. The sequencing cost is dropping every day. It was nearly $100 million when they initially sequenced. Now it's you can sequence it for $500 to $800 genome. The goal is now you get the genome or this various information, feed them into a supercomputer, and that would speed out a proper treatment for a cancer patients. So until now, various experts like pathologists, clinicians, oncologists, basic scientists, we all used to work to some extent together, but not necessarily as a team. What we are doing here at Legorreta Cancer Center and all over the world is forming a team, working as a team to target this devil. So here is a group of the people who are working with me at Brown University and also the Legarreta Cancer Center. Again, I hope I'm able to convince you that the future is bright. It's, you know, we have a hope. And if somebody's cancer is diagnosed early in time, the survival rate is very high. So we need to really work together. So I request all of you to play a vital role in this by participating either by supporting cancer research or participating in clinical trials or simply by promoting awareness among people that cancer is not a death sentence. It's a curable if diagnosed early. So go get proper diagnosis, early diagnosis done. And thank you all for the opportunity.